Welcome to the Cisco Netacad Introduction to Networks video series by Jason Johnson. This video covers Module 8, Part 2 of 2 of the network layer. In Module 8, Part 2 of 2, we're going to look at how a host routes, explain how network devices use routing tables to direct packets to a destination network, and then router routing tables explain the function of fields in the routing table of a router. So how does a host route? There's a host forwarding decision. Packets are always created at the source. Each host device creates their own routing table. And then a host can send packets to the following: their self at 127.0.0.1, which is on a V4, or ::1 on a V6. It can send it to localhost, the destination is on the same local area network, or it can send it to remote host, devices are not on the same local area network. So it can send it to itself or a home address. It can send it to a local host, or it can route it out to a remote host. The source device determines whether the destination is local or remote. And the method of determination is, on a V4, the source uses its own IP address and subnet mask along with the destination IP address. On a V6, the source uses the network address and prefix advertised by the local router. The local traffic is dumped out the host interface to be handled by an intermediary device, and remote traffic is forwarded directly to the default gateway on the LAN. The default gateway is a term you need to be familiar with. A router or layer 3 switch can be a default gateway. A default gateway has these features. It must have an IP address in the same range as the rest of the local area network. It can accept data from the LAN and is capable of forwarding traffic off of the LAN, and it can route to other networks. If a device has no default gateway or a bad default gateway, its traffic will not be able to leave the local area network. A host routes to a default gateway. The host will know the default gateway either statically or through DHCP in IPv4. V6 sends the default gateway through a router solicitation, or it can be configured manually. And the default gateway is a static route, which will be a last resort route in the routing table. And all devices on the LAN will need the default gateway of the router if they intend to send traffic remotely. So let's look at a host routing table on a Windows device. On Windows, route print or netstat -r displays the PC routing table. Three sections displayed by these two commands: interface list, all potential interfaces, and the MAC addressing, the V4 routing table, and the V6 routing table. And you can see an example right here. We put in netstat -r and we get the routing table. We can see our V4 and we can see our gateway and our interface. Introduction to routing. The router packet forwarding decision. What happens when the router receives the frame from the host device? The packet arrives on the gigabit Ethernet 000 or router R1. R1 de-encapsulates the layer 2 Ethernet header and the trailer. The R1 then examines the destination V4 address of the packet and searches for the best match in its V4 routing table. The route entry indicates that this packet's to be forwarded to R2. So router 1 encapsulates the packet into a new Ethernet header and trailer and forwards the packet to the next hop router, R2, where the process starts again, where R2 will do the same process. And we can see our routes here. G000, and then it goes out 001 via R2. The IP router routing table. There's three types of routes in a router's table. You have directly connected. These routes are automatically added by the router, provided the interface is active and has addressing. You have remote, and these are the routes where the router does not have a direct connection and may be learned, either manually with a static route or dynamically by using a routing protocol to have the routers share the information with each other. And then you have the default route. This forwards all traffic to a specific direction when there's not a match in the routing table. Static routing. Static route characteristics. They need to be configured manually. They must be adjusted manually by the administrator when there's a change in the topology. They're good for small, non-redundant networks, and they're often used in conjunction with a dynamic routing protocol for configuring a default route. Dynamic routing discovers remote networks, maintains up-to-date information, chooses the best path to the destination, finds the new best paths when there is a topology change, and dynamic routing can also share static routes with the other routers. So if we look at the show IP route command on a router, we get the following. L shows directly connected local interface IP address. A C is directly connected network. An S is a static route that was manually configured. O is OSPF. And D is EIGRP. So this command here shows types of routes directly connected, CRL, remote, and default routes. If we take a look here, so we have our show space IP space route on our router, and you will get that. And you can test that out on your packet tracer or the routers that you're working with. Okay, so this has been Module 8, Part 2 of 2. And what did we learn? We learned that IP is connectionless. It's best effort and media independent. IP does not guarantee packet delivery. The V4 packet header consists of fields containing information about the packet. V6 overcomes V4 lack of end-to-end connectivity and increased network complexity. A device will determine if a destination is itself, another local host, or a remote host. A default gateway is a router that is part of the LAN and will be used as a door to other networks. The routing table contains a list of all known network addresses or prefixes and where to forward the packet. And the router uses the longest subnet mask or prefix match. And the router table has three types of route entries: directly connected networks, remote networks, and a default route. Okay, I hope this information was helpful, and have a great day.